and I want that coat back within the next 2 hours.
Back in the 1980s, Pete was the lusted after lead singer of Dead or Alive. But a dissatisfaction with his looks led him to an obsession with plastic surgery.
Makeup washes off, so why not have something that doesn't wash off?
Which saw him change his face beyond recognition over the next 20 years. This obsession led to disaster when an operation to increase the size of his lips went horribly wrong.
He held me down on a table, he pierced it, and cups of yellow fluid came out. But he didn't give me a diagnosis, and it just went from bad to worse.
But behind the outrageous looks and the caustic wit is a very different Pete, whose turbulent past has made him the man he is today.
I didn't really have a childhood.
His mother suffered from depression, drug and alcohol dependency throughout his childhood, and attempted suicide several times, often when the young Pete was home alone.
I heard some sound that was just wrong. I pushed everything away from the door upstairs, mm-hmm. and she'd sliced her wrists open and the veins were hanging out.
Over 2 extraordinary days, I was able to give Pete a psychic reading. It was a revelation to both him and me. Finally, I begin to understand what has made this man into the person we know today. I got to be your friend now, baby. And I would like to move in just a little bit closer. Pete Burns is one of the most controversial characters in British music, but I believe he has a strong spiritual side to his personality. I went to meet him at his London home to see what I could pick up from the atmosphere around him.
Pete, I absolutely love your home and also the sense of peace that you feel in it here.
It's kind of fancy, isn't it?
It's fantastic. It really reflects you, I think.
I think we're like Russian dolls in a lot of ways. We have a lot of layers, and I was very aware of that from an early age. What you see on the outside is certainly not what is on the inside.
That's what I feel. Just sitting with you, I can almost feel the different layers of your life and around you, and even in the spirit world, I feel different people around you at different times of your life.
I wish they'd make themselves visible.
The feeling I get from this place tells me that your mother is actually very much around you just now, and especially currently. I feel as though she's been trying to give you signs and information in current times.
I'm very aware of her presence right now. I'm not like Norman Bates in Psycho, who I've idolised as my mother, because as far as parental skills go in the conventional world, she certainly wasn't a mother. And she's the best human being that I've ever had the privilege of being in the company of. And I know that she had a special plan for me. She's called me Star Baby.
Yeah.
And she knew that there was something special in me. Just an incredible German woman, tiny, 5 foot wob, but she could move a wardrobe. She could lift a wardrobe. Mm-hmm. I grew up until I was 5 speaking German and a bit of French. There was no English spoken in my house. My father spoke to my mother in French. She spoke to me in German.
Pete's mother, Eva, was the daughter of a German-Jewish film director, Hugh Quitner, and his wife, Maria. She attended silent film school and planned to follow her family into the film business. But the Second World War was to set the beautiful young Eva on a very different path.
She had an incredible cultural background, and she decided I was not going to have formal education, because what good would the Battle of Hastings do me in life? And she encouraged me to create and create and create, and there were no boundaries, and there was no male or female. She was like, into there's no gender, and a skirt doesn't make a man. And all of these things. So I grew up in a completely open and free environment, which a lot of people think causes problems in life. Well, guess what? It did. But those problems make you stronger.
But I'll tell you what, I don't think your mother's ever far away from you.
I wish she'd make herself known.
Yeah. Oh, she does. She absolutely does. Do you know the lovely thing, and I hope you will know this, I've just seen this most beautiful, beautiful picture of a place that looks like It looks like something out of Hansel and Gretel.
That'll be Salzburg, where she fled to in the war, maybe.
What? It actually feels like something like that, almost. But there's such a lot of mountains in the backdrop.
Salzburg, yeah, where her sister lived. I've seen it already. I've been there.
Have you?
Yeah.
Because that just came into my mind, even as you were talking about your mother, and just this feeling of the amount of, if you like, Germanic connections.
When war broke out, Eva's Jewish father was forced into hiding, but was betrayed by the family chauffeur and died later in a Nazi concentration camp. Eva then went on the run with her mother and eventually met Pete's father, a British soldier, at a soldier's tea dance in Vienna.
She denied she was German. I found that on her passport. She claimed to be Austrian because she was so ashamed of what the Germans had done in the Nazi occupation. She was a German Jew, and I didn't know that until many years later, until I found her passport where she was born, because she said she was born in Salzburg. And she wasn't actually. She was born in Heidelberg, and then she lived in Berlin.
But I actually feel as though a lot of your mother is in you. That somebody like that who's so close to you can't actually die. They dissolve into your heart.
I appreciate that.
But I would assume that you're, even as I look at you and as a medium, I actually almost see your face changing into your mother. And I've never seen a picture of your mother.
That's a bit spooky.
I do.
I've always had an incredible resemblance to her. My eyes are the same physically. I'm built the same. And I never said to a surgeon, make me look like mommy.
So how did the whole cosmetic surgery thing start?
Well, I think from a very early age, I just kind of was very intrigued in that kind of, I thought makeup washes off, so why not have something that doesn't wash off? Yeah. And I didn't know much. It was a long journey.
Pete started having cosmetic surgery in 1985, when his desire for the perfect lips led to a disastrous choice. A permanent solution was injected into his lips to increase their size. It was a chemical to which his body reacted badly. It poisoned his bloodstream, and what followed nearly cost him his life.
One day I did a show with the Scissor Sisters, and I was in pain, quite bad actually, but I didn't say anything. And after the gig, I woke up and my lower lip was, I mean, honestly, it's not a sort of, to say it was that big, that bit. And I called him and he came back from Birmingham and he saw me and he held me down on a table, he pierced it and cups of yellow fluid came out. But he didn't give me a diagnosis and it just went from bad to worse. And eventually holes were appearing in the face and I'd touch my face and it would hiss and yellow stuff would ejaculate from the face. Yeah. But I mean, this is not ill. I'd leave it on the mirror because no one could believe it was coming out of my face, and I was searching for doctors for an answer. And quite by chance, I told my webmaster, Rose Keefe, why I'd disappeared. And she said, but there's a plastic surgeon on the Right Stuff website, which is my website. And she contacted him. His name was Paolo, and he worked for an eminent surgeon in Genoa, Italy, who's a cancer reconstructive surgeon. And he spoke no English. And this wonderful woman called Marina, who's a professor of the English school in Genoa. She didn't know me and she flew over with him to translate. And she said, you're coming to Italy, you're coming to my house, this is what he's gonna do. And I went to Italy thinking I'd get four operations, but when he opened me up, he found the stuff had migrated all over the face and neck area. And he thought four operations, and it ended up like I was there 18 months and it's ongoing for life, really.
In part two, Pete tells me about his 2 years of painful reconstructive surgery.
Two major surgeries a week to save my life, not just my face.
And I also get a chance to see inside his wardrobe to view his incredible clothing collection. Pete Burns was a leading light on the new romantic scene of the late 1980s with his group Dead or Alive. But a dissatisfaction with his appearance led him to experiment with plastic surgery. Over the next 20 years, he had numerous operations until a procedure to enlarge his lips went horribly wrong. Pete was injected with a chemical that poisoned his bloodstream and disfigured his face. What followed was a nightmare 18 months of major surgery to rebuild his looks. Only days after his final reconstructive surgery, Pete entered the Big Brother house. He'd been so ill, he hadn't worked for over 2 years.
I mean, the whole Big Brother time, during and after it, so many people were probably confused about what was going on in your life at that time.
18 months of reconstructive surgery, huge doses of anaesthetic, two major surgeries a week to save my life, not just my face. I had my entire stomach wall removed to get tissue to harvest into my face. I had to be brought home by car because I couldn't fly, and then walking into the Big Brother house, and I was sleep deprived for over 3 weeks. And this sounds like an excuse, and it's not an excuse, it's what it was. And I came out and I couldn't go home, and I was physically ill with the surgery, and I ended up in a hotel, and the press were outside, and I was like not sleeping, and I needed some help, and I didn't want to let anyone down. And I checked into a psychiatric place to put me to sleep. And guess what? Every patient in the psychiatric ward had watched Big Brother, as well as the doctors. So I was no longer human. And they were asking for autographs. And I was like, this drug's killing me. I'm checking out.
It was on Big Brother that Pete caused public outrage when he said he was wearing a coat made of gorilla.
Pete's got a jacket made out of monkey.
My coat is in police custody.
Gorilla? Off.
My coat's been arrested.
And I want that coat back within the next 2 hours.
I am my fair coat.
It was immediately removed by the police for examination and found to be an antique monkey coat. Pete was innocent. All he'd done was buy vintage. But when he left the house, more controversy followed when he was sent to prison for threatening behaviour.
The police decided to have a bit of fun because I'd spoken out about the debacle with the fur coat and said, and I think somebody in a high place thought, hold on, he's making fun of us. And I think the police were actually out to get me. And they did get me.
What did that feel like, being thrown into prison after you'd been through so much already?
Yeah, but I'm a survivor. Everyone is potentially a survivor. It's just they give up far too easily. You know, a survivor can get tired, let them sleep, get back up and survive. But there's really no reason for anything to break anybody ever. That's a choice to let things break you.
Absolutely. I think a lot of people under those circumstances, though, would have crumbled. And I'm talking about the body trauma, not psychologically or mentally, because I met you at that time, and I actually thought
I'm
that
a
you
German
were very...
tank girl.
Yeah, I thought you were very resilient and your mind was actually very on the ball. But your body must have been going through some trauma. How many operations did you have?
There was two a week for 18 months. That's in a five-day span of a week, two a week. So you do the maths, I'm not good with figures. And they were major operations, major. And I was on morphine and pethidine, cancer-based painkillers, and that wouldn't kill the pain. I just made a decision one day, I'm not having this. And I just lit up a cigarette and got on with my life.
In the session, I get a strong sense that the spirit of Pete's mother is very close and wants to connect with him. Knowing his difficult past, I asked Pete to tell me more about what she was like to live with.
A discipline. A discipline was so rigid. Make up on at 5 a.m, clean the house, look after me, change costume at 1 o'clock, clean the house again. The discipline, always to look good, and it didn't matter what you were feeling, look good feeling it.
But you're carrying that baton forward. I mean, to me, you're an extension of your mother.
I know no other way. That's the way. Why, if I feel depressed, why should I sit around looking like
Yeah, absolutely.
I'd rather sob with glamour.
But there's another woman, your grandmother is in the spirit world.
Who's my grandmother? My German
like,
grandmother?
No, it feels like your father's mother.
Oh, Nana, she hated me.
There's an absolute... Do you know
Agnes, she hated me.
The force of that woman is that, as we were talking about your mother...
But does she like me now?
The thing I sense, yeah, I do. Feel as though she's actually...
My dad doesn't.
...changing towards you. Because I feel as though she was a force in herself, a force to be reckoned with.
Nana, Agnes Burns, I know that she made my mum's initial time in England very difficult because it was England, German, and mother couldn't speak English. And my only real memory of my Nana is, yeah, she was lovely to me. She let me put on her daisy earrings. So she wasn't, in fact, yeah, and a high heel, so Nana was really cool. But always I remember the scars left on my mother that Nana... put there.
Do you know what? I actually feel as though there's a great feeling of resolve among those two. Because it's as if your mother's brought her to say, look, use her strength. Use your mother's creativity, or that's something you've got from your mother. But there's such a strong sense of this woman. And just this, almost so resilient, this woman.
A tough lady, yeah.
Real tough. But in the nicest sense, tough.
Actually, she used to buy me dolls and red Indian headdresses, and Nana was very good to me, but it's like when I was very young, she died. So then I have the memory of my mother being so angry with her, but then mother nursed her, so obviously there was some kind of peace that came into that. But you've just opened a realm for me, because I forgot about how great Nana was. Yeah.